Okay.
We're going.
Okay, well, thanks for the invitation. Can you guys see okay? Is this going to work for you? First of all, I tend to pace when I talk, so if I get in your way or something, throw something at me. So again, thanks for the invitation to come and talk to you tonight. I'm going to talk about this disease we've been studying. And what I want to do tonight is first, you know, just explain what this disease is, what, you know, just what we're looking at here, and talk a little bit about why hereditary diseases happen and how they can become very widespread in a breed before anybody realizes something is wrong. But the good news is now we can do something about these diseases. With modern genomics, we have the tools to solve these kind of problems. Not all of them, certainly, but we're getting better and better about doing something about it. And then once we've got the, you know, the DNA test in hand, you have to understand how to use that test properly and to get the best results. So to understand this disease, we've got to kind of go down to some basics about movement and how the brain and the nervous system work. So if this dog decides he's going to do something, his brain gets an idea, I'm going to go run over there and do whatever. That is going to get translated into some movement commands. And those commands are going to go from his brain down the spinal cord. In the spinal cord, they're going to communicate with a peripheral nerve. That information is going to go out the nerve to the muscle. And the muscle is going to contract, and there's going to be some kind of a movement. And that is, the, you know, at a very simplistic level, the process behind how we do anything we want to do. Now, part of, you know, movement involves the larynx, the voice box. So the larynx is the part of the respiratory system that is at, connects the throat with the windpipe and down ultimately into the lungs. Now, if we look down inside this dog's mouth, I hope nobody's too squeamish after this. As a veterinarian, to get used to these sort of things, you forget that some people don't like that sort of view. But if you look down a dog's throat, there's a couple things I want to point out. First of all, this metal speculum that you can see down on the bottom there is holding down what's called the epiglottis, which is a little flap that kind of flops up over the windpipe when we swallow to keep the food going down the right way, to keep us from choking on the food. But we're more interested in, really, for laryngeal paralysis, well, we're interested in both, but back behind that, in the back here, those are the vocal folds, the things that vibrate when the dog barks or when we talk and create sound. Now, when a dog is breathing, what happens is there's muscles in the larynx that pull those vocal folds out of the way. So as the dog inhales, air can move freely into his larynx. Now, this is a dog under anesthesia, so he's not breathing very hard. You can still see how every time he breathes in, those muscles pull open the airway to make it easier for him to breathe. And if he was breathing really hard, if he was running like that dog in the first picture, he'd be really opening that up so he could move all the air in there that he has to move. So laryngeal paralysis is a disease where we have a problem with the movement of the larynx. And so typically a disease of old dogs. If a 8-year-old Labrador retriever goes into a veterinarian breathing like this, you know, as soon as he walks in the door, he's going to say, oh, that dog's got laryngeal paralysis. You because that's where we see this sort of thing all the time. And Labradors are the worst, but a lot of large breed dogs have this as a more degenerative kind of problem as the dogs get older. What's different about the Black Russian Terriers is this starts out very young. All the dogs that we've seen have been around 3 months of age when they first show this problem. And the reason this was a difficult thing to recognize at first is that when a three-month-old dog comes into a veterinarian having trouble breathing, laryngeal paralysis isn't on their radar screen because it doesn't happen in young dogs. You're thinking the dog has kennel cough, or that he has pneumonia, or that he's got strangles, or you know, something else rather than laryngeal paralysis. But these guys come in with classic laryngeal paralysis. And not quite as loud, but if you listen carefully, you can hear them. Kind of wheezy. In contrast with asthma, it's easy when they inhale, whereas asthma is more of an exhale. And so when you see that kind of breathing pattern where they're trouble moving air into their airway, this is what we see with laryngeal paralysis. Now this also affects that epiglottis, that little trap door that's going to close the airway when the dog swallows. And that can result in them inhaling food, and then they do develop pneumonia. So often by the time these guys get into the veterinarian, they do have pneumonia. And because again, right, laryngeal paralysis is not something we typically see in young dogs, they get diagnosed with pneumonia and euthanized, and then the postmortem shows pneumonia. And so that's why this wasn't recognized first. And it kind of snuck in under the radar screen. Now, the polyneuropathy part of this, the name we've given this disease, refers to another part of the problem here. So if I like to tell my students to pick these complex words and kind of break them down into their parts so they can kind of understand them. And the neuro part in the middle there refers to nerves, these things that are carrying the message from the spinal cord out to the muscles to create movement. Poly is going to refer to many. So a polygamist is a guy with many wives. Why somebody would want to do that, I don't know. So poly means many. And pathy just simply means a disease. So polyneuropathy simply means a disease that's affecting many nerves. So it's affecting the larynx, and the laryngeal paralysis is the most prominent symptom, and often the one that, you know, some of these guys die before they get the opportunity, if you will, to develop the rest of it. But they also show weakness. Now, this isn't the best video, but if you watch this dog hops as he's walking, he's kind of collapsing down on his hocks. He's kind of buckling at the hock there. And he's kind of cow-hocked, and his legs kind of wobble and weave a bit. So this dog is showing some early signs of weakness, particularly in the back leg. They also lose sensation in the back legs. They don't know where their legs are. So my intern here, Jeremy, is knuckling this dog's leg under, and he stands there on the top of his paw because he doesn't know what his paw is doing. So those nerves are not only carrying motor information out to the muscle, they're also carrying sensory information back up to the spinal cord and to the brain that's telling the dog, here's where your foot is. It's in a funny position. You better correct it. If they don't have that information, then they'll stand there with that foot knuckled under. And if we look at the nerves in these guys at post-mortem, the nerves are degenerating. So this is a photomicrograph, a histologic section taken at post-mortem of a relatively normal nerve. It's not 100% normal, but it shows you the basic pattern, where you have all these little kind of crinkly circles with a clear center and kind of a dark ring around them. Those are the individual nerve fibers, and that's what they should look like. You should have this nice clear center and all the crinkly stuff around the outside, and the nerve should be just chock full of these fibers. When we look at the nerves in these Black Russian Terriers, the fibers are gone. There's a few surviving ones here, but ultimately they would be completely lost. Now, in addition to these problems with the laryngeal paralysis and polyneuropathy, the other thing that we noticed as we saw more of these dogs is that many of them had eye abnormalities as well. And we'll talk at the end a little bit about why we think this is part of the big picture. So they also have cataracts. And cataracts, like laryngeal paralysis, is another disease that we think of as an old dog disease. It's a degenerative process in the eye with aging. A lot of people, a lot of dogs develop cataracts. And I think many of these dogs, the cataracts weren't even noticed because the dog comes in dying of pneumonia. You're not going to be checking a three-month-old dog to see if he's got cataracts when he's dying of pneumonia. You're going to be dealing with the pneumonia. Some of them have had microophthalmia, which means that the eyes are abnormally small. And there have been a few other more esoteric kind of abnormalities that we've seen in the eyes as well. So this appears to be, you know, part of the picture as well. So we first saw two dogs come into the University of Missouri with this problem. When you see just two pups that have a problem, if they're litter mates and they're, you know, it's the same problem, you start wondering, is it hereditary? But you can't make any conclusion based on, you know, one or two dogs. It could have been something happened during these dogs in development, the mom got a virus or something like that. You know, there's lots that can go wrong and cause problems like this. But then we hear that, you know, there was a prior dog. And you know, if you guys aren't used to looking at pedigrees in this way, this is the way geneticists look at them. The circles are females, squares are males. The symbols shaded in black are dogs that I've confirmed are affected. The ones that are kind of shaded in gray are suspected. And when you do a diamond, it means you don't know what the sex was. So in addition to this male and female that I examined, I heard that the sire had produced a pup in a previous breeding that had a very similar kind of problem. It had been diagnosed with pneumonia. So you start wondering, well, maybe, could this be something hereditary? And then you start looking at the more extended family, collecting, you know, other histories from other veterinarians around the country and ultimately around the world. We find that on the father's side of the pedigree, there are two dogs out here that were confirmed as having laryngeal paralysis polyneuropathy, three or four others that were suspected. On the mom side of the pedigree, again, we've got two pups down there that are affected. Then we get wind of another line of dogs completely unrelated to this particular line that has a couple affected pups. A couple affected dogs show up in England. An affected dog shows up in Czechoslovakia. And so now we can say, yeah, this looks like a hereditary problem. This isn't just coincidence. All these dogs aren't just getting some kind of virus in utero. We have normal pups being born in the litter. About 25% of the litter is affected. We're saying, yeah, this looks like a hereditary disease. And unfortunately, it's very easy for a hereditary disease to take root in a breed. And the reason is kind of illustrated by this dog. And when I show this picture, I always ask people, what do you think of when you see this dog? And I was yet to have anybody say, when I look at that picture, I think, what a stud. But you guys probably do recognize what that is. That is best to show with Westminster. So if you're a poodle breeder, you look at this dog and you think, what a stud. Because this dog is everything that the poodle breeders want, right? You know, if you win best of show at Westminster, that's what, you know, the epitome that everybody aspires to. And so if it's a male, then that male can get widely used. Everybody wants to have some of this stuff in their line too, because this is the right stuff. This is the stuff that wins Westminster. And so a stud that wins big like this will get widely used. And it's only natural. Everybody wants that. Unfortunately, mutations happen. Every dog, every person in this room is carrying probably about a half a dozen recessive mutations, and we'll talk more about recessive and such in a minute here, but potentially disease-causing genes, along with all the desirable ones that made this guy win Westminster. It's just they're recessives, he's a carrier, and we don't know that they're in there. And so this dog goes out, he gets widely used, he starts breeding. For the first generation, everybody's happy because they've got the winner of Westminster in their line. And so they're happy for the first generation. But when this guy's children start breeding with each other, that's when we can see these recessive traits start to come out. And so first we have one pup born up here, that little black guy up there. And this pup just wasn't right. He didn't move right, he was a runt, he was small, and you know, we know runts happen, development's hard work. And so we wouldn't think too much of that. What caught the poodle breeder's attention is these guys also have horrible seizures when they get to be 5 weeks of age and die in terrible seizures. So it's a little more than just, well, this is just a runt who didn't develop quite right. But still, one dog out of a litter, never seen it before, you don't think too much of it. But as time goes on, and more of this dog's offspring are crossbreeding with each other, we start seeing more and more litters where they're losing 25% of the pups in the litter to this disease, and then you know you've got a problem. And these aren't the puppy mill breeders that I deal with in southern Missouri that are the bane of my existence. You know, these are the people like you that are trying to do the right thing, trying to do a good job, trying to breed the best dogs they can. And yet this recessive gene sneaks in there, and before you know it, you've got a problem. So bad dogs happen to good breeders, and it's not inbreeding or, you know, bad breeding. It's just something that happens. So when you have a problem like this crop up in a breed, there are basically two ways you can deal with it. One way to deal with it is the ostrich approach. Just pretend it's not out there. Pretend it'll go away. And some breed, talked to a lot of breed clubs over the years, and I learned that they have their cultures. And some breeds, this is the culture. But I had the feeling that Black Prussian Terrier breeders would not be the kind of stick your head in the sand kind of people with a problem. I had the feeling that you guys would probably view it more from this kind of thing, grab the bull by the horns and do something about it. And so what do you do about it? Well, what we can do now about it is find the gene that's responsible for this problem. And fortunately, I've got a great gene jockey in Gary Johnson. Gary has been doing canine genetics before genomics was a word. He was actually an Irish Terrier breeder before he became a veterinarian. Got interested in clotting disorders, and that got him interested in hereditary diseases. And I can't mention Gary and his lab and the great work they do without mentioning Liz Hansen, who's the one who keeps Gary in line. Liz, of course, is a standard Schnauzer breeder who's won Best of Show at our Best of Breed at Westminster. And she understands the breed clubs and, you know, keeps track of all the genetics of things. So to get into kind of how we go about solving a problem like this, and though I deal with neurologic diseases, and that's what I'm going to be, you know, talking about here, this applies to any hereditary problem. I know a lot of you guys have a background in genetics and understand some of this stuff, but just so everybody's on the same page, I like to start very basic and kind of build up. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the ABCs of DNA. So about the same time Elvis Presley was cutting his first record with Sun Records in Memphis, Watson and Crick figured out how DNA worked. And they figured out that DNA consisted of this very short alphabet of nucleic acids. So there are only four nucleic acids, we'll just call them A, T, C, and G because the names don't mean anything, that are put together to form the genes, to form all the genetic material that we have. And what their big discovery was this double helix and the fact that all of these DNA molecules are paired. So C is always paired with G, T is always paired with A. And the reason that pairing is important is those two strands of DNA can then get kind of pulled apart. And the body can then fill in the blanks, add the pair to that naked strand. And as it does so, it creates an exact duplication of the DNA that was there. And this is how cells reproduce, how they replicate themselves. The DNA splits apart, an exact duplicate of it is made. One copy goes to one cell, one copy goes to the other cell. And that's how replication and reproduction and such occur. Now we can take this analogy of an alphabet even further and think about, you know, books. So if the nucleic acids are the alphabet of the DNA world, the same way letters of the alphabet are put together into a string to form a word, these nucleic acids are put together into a string to form what's called a codon. And each of those codons is going to code for a different amino acid. So the same way every word has a meaning, every one of these codons says this is a particular amino acid. And the same way the alphabet is short, these words are short. There are always these little three codon strings. And each one is a command to make a different amino acid. Now, the same way a word can be put together with other words in a sentence to form a whole idea, all these codons are put together to form a protein. So this string of amino acids folds up into a three-dimensional structure that creates a protein that are the building blocks of our body and let us do everything we need to do. Sentences in a book are going to be collected together into groups that we call chapters. And all these genes are collected together in groups, too, that are called a chromosome. And now we're getting to the level where we can actually see something under the microscope. So we can see these groups of genes that are put together into a chromosome. And we can identify different chromosomes because they look a little bit different. They're a little bigger or shorter. The bands are a little bit different. And so now we're getting to the level of things that we can actually see. And finally, we can put those chapters together into a book that's going to contain a whole story. And that's what we're referring to as a genome. So all the chromosomes that make up the genetic material of that individual dog is that dog's genome. So all the genetic material that makes this dog who he is, why he's a good dog or a bad dog or whatever, besides the, you know, training and such that go into it after that, is contained in that dog's genome. And finally, we can have books that are a series, where you have common characters, common themes, things like the Harry Potter series, or the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, or whatever. And this is essentially the equivalent of a breed, where you've got enough commonality in the genomes of all those different dogs that we can say this is a Black Russian Terrier. But the same way you can have a villain in one of these series, like Lord Voldemort, or actually the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo is a better example because the bad guy actually had a hereditary disease. Have you guys read that series? Yeah. The bad guy had hereditary insensitivity to pain. So you could punch him in the face, he wouldn't feel it, and, you know. Anyway, that's not. So anyway, when we talk about sequencing a gene, all we're doing is reading the sentence. You know, we're just reading those nucleic acids, and we get a printout that looks like this, where it just says, this sentence reads, T-T-T-T-T-T-A-A-A-T-T-T-T-T-T-T-T. And that's the genetic code for that gene. Now, in any given dog, they've got two versions of each chapter. And so these two versions are kind of, you know, working either with or against each other. So when the mother forms an egg in the ovary, she only puts one version of her story, one of her chromosomes into that egg. The father does the same thing with his sperm. And when the two of those get together, and now we've got two versions of the story in one egg, that's a fertile egg and goes on to develop a pup. But that each egg, then a fertilized egg, has two versions of each chapter, of each chromosome. And in those chromosomes, there's going to be two versions of each gene, one from the mother and one from the father. And these versions can be the same, so we can have a homozygous condition where the mom and the dad are both telling the pup the same story. Or sometimes we can have a heterozygous situation where there's different versions of the story. So if this gene is, say, responsible for getting the animal ready for the show, maybe the dad is telling the pup, get the dog ready for a show. The mom's telling the kid, get the cat ready for a show. We've got two different versions of the story going on here. And one of those versions is going to dominate. And so if dad tells you to give the dog a bath, mom tells you to give the cat a bath, every time you give the cat a bath, she scratches you and you don't like that, the teenager gives the dog a bath every time. And so that's the dominant trait, the one that wins the day every time and is expressed. Whereas give a cat a bath is recessive, because the kid never wants to give the cat a bath, and so it doesn't get done. Now, if we look at how these things work in practice with a simple example like coat color, we've got two dogs here, a male and a female, brown and white, respectively. And let's say both of these dogs are homozygous. So the brown dog is homozygous for the brown coat color. The white dog is homozygous for the little c, and the way in genetics they express these things is the capital letter is dominant, the small case letter is recessive. But both of these dogs are pure to that trait. You know, they're both homozygous, and if we bred homozygous brown dogs to homozygous brown dogs, we'd always get brown and so on. So each gene is the same. But if we breed these two dogs together and look at their offspring, they all come out brown. And that's because the brown is dominant. They would have gotten whichever version of the story they got from dad, it would be a brown version. Whichever version of the story they got from mom would be the white version. The brown version is dominant, so all the pups are brown. But they're heterozygous. They're carriers of the recessive white trait. Where things get interesting is if you breed two carriers with each other. Because even though these dogs are brown, interesting things happen. About 25% of the pups from this breeding will get the dominant brown gene from each parent and be homozygous brown. Some will get the dominant brown from dad, some from mom, but the opposite one from the other parent. And they'll be brown also, but they'll be carriers of the white trait. And then finally, about 25% on average of the pups will get both of the recessive white genes from mom and dad. And those will be the white pups. But you can't look at any of the other dogs and tell which ones are carriers of the trait and which ones aren't. The only way to really tell without genetic testing is to do a trial breeding, breed two dogs together, and see if you get a white pup out of it. Now, we said mutations happen, and they do. And all it means when we say a mutation has happened is that there's been some change in the DNA. Something has damaged the DNA. And so there's been a change in that sequence. And so now, where that damage has occurred, when we start replicating that strand of the DNA, it's different. There is something different about that particular sequence. And so there's been a change in the gene. And sometimes that just forms a new functional form of the disease. Maybe that's the brindle coat, or maybe it's give the cow a bath, if we're talking about this bathe the animal for the show gene. And so that kind of thing happens all the time, and sometimes those are desirable things. Maybe you wanted to have a brindle coat in this particular breed, and now you've got it. Other times, though, that mutation can interfere with the function of that gene, and then we've got a disease, because now we can't get the animal to the show because you got killed by the tiger, and so, you know, that ain't good. And so this is when disease happens, when we have a mutation that's interfered with a necessary function. So what we've got to do now is find that mutation that's causing the disease. The trouble is that mutation is hidden somewhere on 39 pairs of chromosomes in the dogs, which contains about 20,000 different genes. And we've got to sort through those and try to figure out, well, which one is the culprit here. The way we've been doing this up until recently is with gene mapping techniques. And here basically we're looking for an association of the disease with some marker genes. And I'm not going to go in great detail on this. But basically each one of these colored bars here represents one of the chromosomes. Each of these little dots is a marker that we're using to identify different genes on that chromosome. And what we're looking for here is an association between these markers. They've got nothing to do with disease. They're just variations like brown and white coat color or something. But if there is an association, if that disease-causing gene is on a particular chromosome, more of those markers are going to be common in the affected dogs than in the unaffected dogs. And we get something like you see in chromosome 2 here, where there's a great big peak that says, Dogs that have the disease got this version of chromosome 2 much, much more often than dogs that didn't have the disease. And then we have only one out of 39 chromosomes to go searching for, but it's still, you know, quite a search to find it even when we start getting that close. But the other geneticist, genomicist that I've had the pleasure of working with is Jerry Taylor. Jerry's actually a cattle genomics guy, and Jerry is a Aussie, he's from Australia, and he's a cowboy. He's basically a very blunt guy, and we were sitting around one day about 5 years ago trying to figure out how to better do these things, and Jerry's answer was, just sequence the whole damn thing. Forget about all this mapping, let's just do whole genome sequences. The kind of thing they did for the whole the Human Genome Project about 15 years ago now for millions of dollars, but the Canine Genome Project about 2005, so it's 10 years ago now. It's now gotten to the point where we can do whole genome sequences on individuals in a cost-effective manner. And so that's what we're starting to do now. And what we'll get is the entire story of that individual dog. Now that's about 3 billion base pairs, so that's a lot of data. So it's basically the equivalent of saying, we now know the name of everybody on the planet, we've got to figure out which of those names is the one that is the culprit that actually caused this. And so how do we do that? But to do that we need 2 things. Number one, we need a lot of computer power, because this is a lot of data to crunch, and you need a schnabel. And this is my schnabel, Bob Schnabel. Bob is a bioinformatics guy, he's a computer geek, who knows how to deal with these 3 billion base pair kind of data sets and use these computers to figure out of those 3 billion potential culprits, which is one or at least a small subset of them that we have to look at. And so what Bob does is what we call a case control study. So we will sequence the entire genome of an affected dog. And somewhere in those 3 billion base pairs, there's going to be a homozygous pair that is the cause of this disease. And so now we've got to figure out, well, which of those 3 billion is the culprit. And the way Bob does that is he takes this dog and compares him to about 100 other dogs. We've got more than that now. We're probably up to about 120. We have sequenced for other reasons. Some of them are dogs that colleagues have sequenced as part of other research projects. A lot of them are dogs with different diseases that we have sequenced. But none of them have laryngeal paralysis polyneuropathy. So even if this dog down here has degenerative myelopathy and the one over on the right has a hereditary epilepsy, it's not going to be the same culprit as we would see in the dog with laryngeal paralysis polyneuropathy. That should be unique to that disease. So Bob can put all these data sets, so we're talking about 3 billion times 101, through his computer algorithms and pull out what's different about our dog with the disease versus all these other guys. And what we get out of that is a whole genome sequence that when we get the data back, we go looking at these things and we'll find something like this. So this is a sequence. You can see all the TCAGs kind of lined up there. The reason there's multiple ones of them is a little more complicated than I want to get into. But the point is, when you look at all those lines of sequence, all those, you know, repeated sentences there, there's a letter missing in the middle of every one. And so that's a mutation. That nucleic acid was binged out for some reason. And this is unique to that Black Russian Terrier with that disease. We didn't see this in any of the other 100 and some odd dogs with other diseases. Now we actually have a list of about a dozen that we had to work through, but taking 20,000 genes down to about a dozen is very workable. And so the next thing we do, once we found a mutation like this in one dog, we have to then say, well, is this something else? Is this maybe what makes the Black Russian the best dog in the world because they have this mutation rather than the disease-causing one? So what we do is we look for what we call concordance. Every affected black terrier should have this mutation, should be homozygous for it. All the normal dogs should not be homozygous for it. All the parents should be carriers. And if everything lines up and we have a big enough family like this, then eventually we hit the point of statistical significance where we can say this couldn't have happened by chance. This has to be the disease-causing gene. And then, as we'll talk about in a bit, we do a few other steps here as well. So once we've found that mutation, then we can use that to develop a DNA test. And this is kind of what the results of a test will look like, where you'll get these little bars on a gel, and I'm not going to get into the chemistry of it, it's boring. The bottom line is we can differentiate based on where these bands line up here, that this band up here is the normal sequence. So that's what the sentence should be. This band down below is the mutated one, the one where that one nucleic acid has been pinged out of there and made this mistake in this dog's sequence. And so we can tell that these dogs over here that only have the mutant allele are the ones that are at risk for developing the disease. Whereas these dogs over here that are clear of that mutation are homozygous for the normal allele. And the ones in the middle there that have one copy of each are the carriers. So with that information then, we can test breeding animals. And we can see which ones are carriers of that trait. So we can do testing. We can say out of this litter that, you know, one is a carrier, two are clear. And then all we do is eliminate the carriers from the breeding programs, just get rid of them, and that will solve the problem, right? Well, it will, but it's not the right thing to do. Because when we're thinking about this, we have to think about the health of the population as a whole, rather than just this one particular problem. Because we may eliminate a third of your breeding stock with a DNA test like this. When we first started testing poodles for that neonatal syndrome, we found a third of the dogs we tested were carriers. That would be a huge chunk of the breeding population that we would have eliminated if we had eliminated every carrier from the breeding stock. And there would be certain lines that would have more carriers than others, and you'd eliminate those lines. But what if the other lines that weren't carriers of this particular problem happened to be carriers of another problem, like hypermyotoceria, one of those plumbing diseases that I don't deal with. I don't need to do wiring. But it's out there. I know there's a DNA test for it, and you guys too. So okay, well, let's test for that. And we'll take those guys out of the breeding population as well. So now we've eliminated another third of our breeding population. And so you're getting fewer and fewer choices of who to breed who to. And also, if we go back to that poodle that, you know, may have been the source of all this to begin with, there was a reason everybody wanted to use him. He had a lot of desirable traits that you want in your breed. If you eliminate all those carriers who happened to get to be carriers because they were descendants of this dog who was good in every other respect, you get rid of all those desirable traits as well. And so that's not healthy for the population of the breed. You get a smaller and smaller gene pool that just concentrates other problems, and that's not the wise strategy. So we have to think about the health of the population and continue to use carriers in the breeding program, but use them wisely. So the idea is to test and never breed two carriers together. If you never breed two carriers together, you're never going to produce an effective pup, because you're never going to produce a homozygous situation in that litter, as long as one of the parents is clear. But now when we're looking at this litter, though, and trying to decide who's going to be the best dog to keep for next generation of breeding, you want to use the genetics, the DNA test status, as one of the considerations for deciding which of these three pups should I keep. If this pup down here is a carrier that has all the other right stuff in every other respect, you can still use it. You just have to make sure the other parent has been tested and is clear, and you can keep the good stuff that you liked about that pup, but gradually over time, next generation, hopefully you'll find one who's clear of the disease, that's got all the other right stuff, then he becomes your breeding stock, and you increase the incidence of the disease in the population slowly over time without creating this dramatic genetic bottleneck that trades the devil you know for the devil you don't. Now, the other thing I wanted to mention briefly here is these guys that have the homozygous mutation, the ones that we label as at-risk. And it's a very conscious decision to call these guys at-risk rather than affected. Because a DNA test, like any diagnostic test, is not a diagnosis. Just because a dog has an elevated liver enzyme doesn't mean he has hepatitis. I mean, I have elevated liver enzymes. I have a hereditary condition myself called Gilbert syndrome. I never knew I had it because it doesn't mean anything. I guess whenever my physician checks my blood, I have to tell him, don't freak out when you see my bilirubin, I've got Gilbert syndrome. So it's not a diagnosis. It means this guy is at risk for disease. And some of these hereditary diseases are variable, where we can have what we call variable penetrance, where not every dog who's at risk develops the disease. And until we've done a lot more DNA testing and followed up on a lot more of these dogs, we can't say for JLPP, is this 100% penetrant or not. For some diseases, like degenerative myelopathy, the penetrance is real variable. For others, it's 100%. You've got the mutation, you've got the disease. But even then, you want to see the clinical signs before you say, yes, this is the disease. So if you have a dog that tests as at risk and shows some signs, just see your veterinarian about it. You know, they may not have laryngeal paralysis on their radar screen for a three-month-old pup, but you can educate them about it. And then they can help you figure out, you know, do the laryngeal exam and see, does this dog have laryngeal paralysis or not? The other thing that we would ask, if you do end up, you know, by accident coming up with a pup who tests at risk, is to contact us, because we need to find the exceptions so that we can say, yeah, there is, you know, this much penetrance, that about 1 out of 1,000 doesn't penetrate, and then we've got better information for it. The other reason I'd like you to contact us is because we don't know what this gene does. We've got some ideas, but we don't really know why these pups develop these problems because of this gene. Some of the genes, it's a slam dunk. You know, we've got a problem in Jack Russell Terriers. It's a potassium channel mutation. Makes perfect sense why this potassium channel mutation messes those guys up. This gene, we don't know. And there are children with this disease as well, with the mutations in this particular gene. They have polyneuropathy, they've got ocular abnormalities, and they have a mutation in the same gene. So as a veterinarian, I've got it fairly easy, really. I can euthanize my patients if I can't help them. If this is somebody's child, I can't euthanize them, and I work a lot with folks at the med school that deal with these situations. And so we try to also understand, well, what do these genes do? You know, so, yeah, I can get rid of it in Black Russian Terriers. If all you guys test your breeding stock and never breed your terriers together again, I'll never see it again. But, you know, it's not that simple in human medicine. So we try to learn from these guys. I may not be able to help that pup that has laryngeal paralysis, but he or she may be able to help, you know, us understand this disease better. And if we can find answers, you know, to that sort of thing, then sometimes that can translate into therapy. We've studied a disease in dachshunds called Batten disease that has an equivalent disease in children. We've been working with somebody over at the med school, the researcher Marty Katz, and Marty has worked with a biotech company out in California. And based on the work we did in the dachshunds, they now have a therapy in clinical trials in Europe for these kids. So that's kind of the ultimate best case scenario is if we can get rid of the disease in your breed, but at the same time learn something that we can kind of help these kids with their problems as well. Okay, so what I wanted you guys to get out of this here today was first of all to be able to recognize this disease, to know what it looks like. Now often these guys, you know, now that we know what it is, we know we can test it, we will be able to tell if we can pick up on this a little bit early. But as of now, you know, we haven't been able to pick up on any of these till about 3 months of age. I had one breeder that I worked with that was convinced she could see it at 5 weeks of age. She sent us a pup, you know, she euthanized a pup. He didn't have any problem and he doesn't have the mutation. So, you know, it's easy to kind of fool yourself. But now with the DNA test, we know, you know, who's at risk and who isn't. And so these guys may get, you know, placed in homes, you know, before they start developing signs. And so he's got to be able to recognize, you know, what the phone call is going to sound like if somebody calls you and you've gotten unlucky and produced one of these pups. Although with the DNA test, you shouldn't have to. I wanted you to just understand some of these basic genetic principles because you've got to understand what a recessive and a dominant trait are and what it means to have a carrier to understand the genetics of these things. But I hope you can also appreciate the promise that this genomic work has. As an aside, the dog that we did the whole genome sequence on for this particular problem had a homozygous mutation in another gene that was kind of one of these slam dunk mutations where it wasn't just one little nucleic acid dinged out like this. I mean, the entire, about 90% of the gene was gone. So we could say clearly, just looking at that, this gene never functioned. That particular mutation causes a hereditary hormonal problem in children. Is that out there in the breed? I don't know. You know. So I think as we do more and more of these whole genome sequences, we're going to get to that point of personalized medicine where we're going to start sequencing dogs routinely. And if you've got a, you know, the Black Russian Terrier who's won Westminster this year and is going to be used breeding everywhere, maybe we should think about doing whole genome sequences on that dog and seeing just what he has. Now that's where they're getting to in human medicine. They do, if you have a child who has a hereditary, well, a congenital problem, it is becoming pretty routine now to just do a whole genome sequence on the child. And, see, is he carrying is he homozygous for any mutations in the diseases that we know cause congenital problems in children? The difference we have as, you know, veterinarians and dog breeders is you can also use that information to guide breeding decisions and think about how we're going to, who we're going to breed to who. Now, there's still a lot of work that needs to get done before we get to that point. You know, this is still in its infancy. But I think in about another 5 years, you're going to start seeing where, you know, and the Moore's Law, you know, that computer thing about, you know, cost going down exponentially applies to this sort of stuff too, because it's all computerized technology sort of thing. So, you know, the cost of whole genome sequencing is, you know, become affordable. We wrote a grant 5 years ago to get this started. And between the time we submitted the grant and we got approval and started doing it, the price cut by a third, down to a third of what it was when we submitted the grant. So we were able to do three rather than just one like we had planned on. So I think it's going to become more and more affordable. And probably the most important thing, I think, is that you have to use these DNA tests wisely. The knee jerk is to want to, you know, get rid of all the carriers, just, you know, eliminate it. But that is not healthy for the breed. It creates other problems and is not the ultimate answer. But if you're careful about who you breed to who and you test everybody, then you know you can avoid the disease. Now, I like to end this talk with this picture. This is me in a previous life. I didn't have the color of wisdom. And that's a lake in Idaho that will forever remain nameless. Some buddies of mine and I went on a fishing trip. We had hiked all day. It was sleeting most of the day, and then it started to snow very heavily. We had done this all day. We finally got into this lake where we were going to go fishing. We threw our packs down, put on our fishing poles, went fishing, and that was not. We didn't catch a thing. And we were feeling very disheartened. We're cold, we're wet, we're tired, we're hungry. And my my buddy Razzo pulled out the map and started looking at it, and he said, you know, if we climb this ridge here, there's another lake up there. I like the looks of that. And everybody said, you're crazy. No, Steve, you can't climb that ridge and go up there and go fishing. Let's just go to bed. No, I want this. This is good. So yeah, we put our packs back down. We climbed another 500 feet up this ridge. We found this little hanging lake there. I got my fishing pole out first. My first cast, I caught the best trout I've ever seen. You can't really appreciate how big that guy in the end is. And it was like that for 2 days. We stayed there for 2 days and ate nothing but fish, breakfast, lunch, dinner. It was a beautiful lake. The sun came out, everything was right with the world. We could have just as easily climbed that 500-foot ridge and gotten skunked again and not caught it. That's what research is like. You know, we don't know what we're going to find when we get into it. But, you know, in the case of the Black Russian Terriers, you know, we found the lake, you know, I mean, we still had to climb that ridge, but we found it, we caught it, we have it. This has been about a year worth of, you know, genetic research. All the background, the collecting, the pedigrees and stuff goes back quite a bit longer. Actually goes back to Nicholas Granger in England, who saw the first two dogs with this back in, I think, 2005. He mentioned that. But we've had other diseases that we've been working on for decades now and still haven't solved, but we keep working on it. We keep casting out there because that's what fishing is all about. The other thing that's important about the nature of this sort of research is that we can't do it without the help of breeders and dog owners. I saw two of these dogs, but you know, the breeders help me find others, the veterinarians I have contact with help me find others. We have to collect DNA from the families, which requires help from the owners of dogs that may not want to hear that their sire produced a pup who has a problem. But I hope I've convinced you that that shouldn't be a stigma now, that now we can attack these things and do something about them if people work with us. But I couldn't do it without you, and we couldn't do it without the funding that the club provided. And so, thank you.
Thank you.
And that's all. Swabs are good for a test. We just need enough DNA to do the test. That's all you need. They're great. When we're doing the research, we often need a lot of DNA because we'll go through sometimes, you know, 30, 40, 100 genes sequencing them, trying to find the culprit, and we chew up all the DNA from the swabs pretty quickly. So it's just a cheek swab. Just go to the OFA website. It's on there. Look under the weed on the Heckler Europe of Syria. It's there. Do the cheek swab and get the test. The other thing I should mention is even though, you know, OFA charges for it, nobody at the University of Missouri makes a dime off these tests. Any extra, you know, above the cost of doing the test that Gary's lab takes in is what goes to, you know, helping get the next test going, next round of research going. And so, you know, and they're pretty reasonable.
What's the turnaround time of the DNA test coming into OFA?
You'd have to ask Liz that. You know, I'm not on that side, but usually it's within a week or two. Yeah. And if it's an unusual situation, we can often turn them around more quickly. But we try to batch the DNA test. It's a lot more cost effective if you do 20 at a time rather than one at a time. So typically they'll do them, you know, like once a week they'll have a battery of tests that they run. Sometimes they can get a lot in. They'll run them more frequently. But Liz is the one to you know, direct all those questions to. Canine genetic diseases is our website. You can find Liz through there, or you can email me, and I can
said, Liz is the one who keeps everything organized in the lab. Gary is very, he's a brilliant researcher, but, you know, he needs a Liz, like I need a Schnapp.
Yeah. Which specific gene does the test measure?
We're not saying that yet, because one of the problems with DNA research is, you know, research through 3 billion nucleic acids to find that one. As soon as we say it's this, somebody else could go out tomorrow and replicate that work and publish it for us. And you know, the real goal here is to help everybody and all that, but I've got to make get publications to get, you know, my boss happy and all that. So when we publish the results, it becomes public domain and anybody can run the DNA test if they want to. But I've got an abstract that I'm writing right now that's going to be presented at ACWM, and we hope to have the publication out by the end of the year.
What?
By the end of this year.
Yeah, by the end of this year.
What is your test measuring specifically, i.e. the DNA, RNA, or protein?
DNA. So, if I can, and, you know, again, I'm not the gene jockey. I'm more the, you know, the clinical side of things. But this is an example, that gel I showed you. Is an example of what one of these tests look like. Where did it go? Where is it? I can't see. My eyes are going bad. Oh, I can't find it now. There it is. So this is what it looks like, you know. And you may, this is the actual DNA. So we get the cheek swab of the blood, extract the DNA from it. Mm-hmm. And there are different ways of doing these kind of tests. But when, I don't think how to explain this simply. But basically you can take advantage of the fact that there is that slight difference in there. And the sequences are unique enough that you can look at, you know, you can devise a test that basically says, look at this particular part of this sentence and see if there's a, you know, a single letter missing out of it or not. And if the letter is missing, then the weight of the DNA is just a titch smaller than the weight of the DNA that has the mutation, and that's, you know, the basis of, you know, that kind of a test.
And really this is all coming down to a huge question in my mind. Is how reliable is a test?
Yeah, and you know, when we don't put a test out until we're confident about it, you know, we
at what confidence interval?
I don't have the p value. Okay. Gary's, you know, hasn't given me that yet. Mm-hmm. It'll be in the publication too. If you look at our past publications, we've had p values with, you know, usually about a dozen zeros in them, so they're good.
Asymptomatic. Mm-hmm. Is there a period of time where you say, okay, I'm good, I don't have to worry about this?
All the pups we've seen so far are presented right at about 3 months of age. Now, we're still learning about it too. And, you know, it's not going to be until I've studied this disease for longer before I'm going to be able to say for sure that a pup can't develop the disease until 6 months of age. But right now, every single one of these guys has been right at 3 months of age. And they've, none of them, well, I know of one dog that was nursed along to a year, and then the owner stopped communicating with me. I presume she died, because she was, you know, she was not doing well, put it that way. But all the others have, you know, been, you know, either developed pneumonia and died, or been getting very weak and, you know, having trouble swallowing. We did do swallow studies, I didn't get into that, on two of these dogs, and they had definite swallowing problems as well. And so that's what worries me about these guys and why I would recommend euthanasia in any of them, because the last thing I want a dog to die of is choking on their food.
Are there other breeds that have this mutation as well, and will this test be effective for them?
We think so. We're working on that. We think there are other breeds that have a similar kind of problem, and we think it's the same gene, and we're actively on that right now. That's going to go a lot more quickly than this did, because we know what we're looking for now. So I suspect within 6 months we'll probably have some other papers on. Yeah.
I believe Leonberger and the St. Bernards publish in PLOS Genetics with the ARHGT,
right.
Genetic defect.
Yep.
Very, very similar
yep.
symptoms.
One of the nice things about the whole genome sequence, we can look at that, you know,
yeah.
and we did. You know, we looked through all that, through that gene. There weren't any homozygous variants in that one.
Okay.
And, you know, the advantage of that is, you know, we could do the test, the Leonberger test on these guys. But one of the problems with DNA testing is it is, you know, the problem is it's almost too specific. And the good example of this is the degenerative myelopathy.
Okay.
You know, we found the SOD1 mutation in degenerative myelopathy in boxers and
yeah.
Pembroke Welsh corgis. We looked at a lot of other breeds. You know, we found the same mutation in a lot of other breeds associated with degenerative myelopathy, except the Bernese Mountain Dogs. We had Bernese Mountain Dogs that we euthanized. They had degenerative myelopathy. They didn't have the mutation.
Mm-hmm.
So Gary sequenced the gene in the Bernese Mountain Dogs, and they've got a different mutation in the same gene. So the DNA test, this kind of thing, is for that specific mutation. A different mutation in the same gene can cause the same disease, and you won't detect it. The PNA in Kerry Blue Terriers is another one. We found the mutation for that, but Chinese crested dogs have the same thing, but a different mutation.
Mm-hmm.
So the Kerry Blue Terrier test doesn't work in the Chinese cresteds and vice versa.
And you got that with the PRA too.
Yeah, PRA, well, there's about a dozen different PRAs. So there can be other genes, and the Leonbergers, they've never reported any ocular abnormalities.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think the jury's still out on these ocular changes. Because a lot of these pups weren't examined very carefully for that.
Mm-hmm.
If a pup comes in dying of pneumonia, you're not looking to see whether he's got cataracts. And so all three dogs that we examined and performed postmortems on had cataracts and persistent pupillary membranes and
mm-hmm.
Microophthalmia and obviously congenital abnormalities. The kids who have mutations in this gene have, in addition to polyneuropathy, ocular abnormalities.
Mm-hmm.
They also have severe mental retardation, which the pups don't seem to have. You know, these pups have all seemed, bright and intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
So there can be some differences there. It's still possible that the ocular things could be something different, but I think not, because we look into it, it's probably going to be the same thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does it typically progress from the original paralysis to polyneuropathy, like a pup that was showing the symptoms of polyneuropathy?
All the dogs that I've examined or have been contacted about have started with the laryngeal paralysis is what got them into the veterinarian. They were breathing hard, they had pneumonia, they had exercise intolerance. And the one of the dogs I examined was dying. I couldn't really tell whether he was weak or not, his pneumonia was so bad. The other two had weakness, but it was still pretty mild. Now, the dog that lived for a year, I wish the owner would have worked more with me. She would send me videos occasionally, but he got pretty bad on the weakness over time. She really couldn't walk anymore and was, had to just be nursed by hand. But whether the neuropathy could precede the laryngeal paralysis, I don't think so, but I don't know. Now that and that's one of the nice things about having these, DNA tests. Now I can say, okay, this dog has that mutation, but he had the polyneuropathy first. Okay, now I can say the polyneuropathy, can come first. Probably the Jack Russell Terriers are the best example there. The Jack Russell Terriers, they have this potassium channel mutation, and they have what we call spinocerebellar ataxia. They're just uncoordinated. The legs just move every which way rather than in a coordinated fashion. some of the dogs had these uncontrollable muscle twitches as well. Some of the dogs had seizures as well. Some of the dogs had the uncontrollable muscle twitches and not the seizures. Some of the dogs had cerebellar ataxia and neither of the other two. Once we found the mutation, we could kind of sort all that out. And we know that all of the dogs with the mutation in the Jack Russells have the ataxia. 80% of them have the muscle twitches, but only about 10-20% of them actually have seizures. But we know now that there's another group of Jack Russell Terriers that only have cerebellar ataxia, and it's not the mutation we found. In fact, the folks at the Animal Health Trust in England have now figured out what that one is. And so once we, and that simplifies sorting these things out, once we know that, okay, this mutation causes, you know, signs like this, we can tell who that group is and focus on, you know, dogs that don't have that mutation but have similar signs like the Leonbergers or, you know, some of these other breeds and know, okay, they don't have the this mutation or mutation in this gene, and we might have to sequence it, but we would. Now let's go looking for another culprit there.
I did have one. The dogs that you've examined from the BRT population sample here, primarily from the U.S. Dog population?
All of them that I've examined.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
But we know, you know, we've gotten DNA samples from England, Czechoslovakia, Sweden. You know, we've gotten them from all over the world.
Okay.
And that's another nice thing is, you know, this is not a, you know, we work with the folks at the Animal Health Trust and what's the name of the institute? University of Helsinki. I can't think of the Hanslogi. I can't think of the name of his institute now. But you know, we work with people overseas. You know, and it's easy to, well, it's not easy to ship blood through customs. You know, sometimes that creates problems. But we can do it, and the cheek swabs are pretty easy. Other questions?
Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you.